Hello, good morning. It's Monday, it's 9:15. I'm Victoria Derbyshire. Welcome to our programme. I was naive to support the Taliban and I regret doing so. The words of Baba Ahmed, jailed in the States for supporting the Taliban online. In an exclusive interview on this programme, the former IT support worker from London also tells us so-called Islamic State are alien to his heritage and beliefs.
Think deeply and carefully about what you are doing and don't allow yourselves to be a pawn. Don't allow yourselves to be used by other people. Don't let anyone bully you that the only way to paradise is by bringing misery upon innocent people who have done nothing to you.
Watch that interview throughout the programme this morning. Also on the programme, Turkish warplanes have hit Kurdish rebel targets in northern Iraq after a car bombing killed 37 people in the capital Ankara. Turkey's president is vowing to bring terrorism to its knees. We'll get reaction. And Chris Evans has apologised unreservedly after scenes for the new Top Gear were filmed near the Cenotaph in central London. Hello, welcome to the programme. We're live on BBC Two and the BBC News Channel until 11 o'clock this morning. Throughout the programme, we'll bring you the latest breaking news. Your views are a big part of each morning too. Here's how to get in touch. Use the hashtag VictoriaLive. If you text, you'll be charged at the standard network rate. Wherever you are, you can watch the programme online via the BBC News app or our website bbc.co.uk/Victoria. This morning, in an exclusive interview, a British man jailed over a website considered to be a key moment in the birth of internet jihad tells us he had been naive to support the Taliban. 41-year-old Baba Ahmed was convicted of two counts of providing material support to terrorism and sentenced to 12 and a half years in prison. The former IT support worker from London had fought a record eight-year-long campaign against extradition for offences committed in the UK. British authorities didn't charge him, but he later pleaded guilty in the States. Two articles posted on a website he founded called Azam urged Muslims back in 2001, before the 9/11 attacks, to send money and equipment to the Taliban, who at the time were harbouring Osama bin Laden and al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. In his first TV interview since his release from a high-security prison in the States 8 months ago, Baba Ahmed tells us he was wrong to support the Taliban back then. He alleges he was hooded by officers in the Met Police, a practice that breaches Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights. He condemns so-called Islamic State as alien to his heritage and beliefs and talks about meeting Labour's London mayoral candidate Sadiq Khan twice since his release from prison. We'll play you the interview in just a moment, but first, here's what you need to know about his case.
Baba was very insistent on the need for military experience and adventure. He thought that was an essential part of a young devout Muslim's upbringing. And it was a very cool message which resonated with a lot of young people.
he ought to be viewed as, in this country and overseas, as a terrorist. The fact that he didn't blow himself up, the fact that he didn't pilot one of those airplanes, the fact that he didn't kill soldiers or innocents in other parts of the world is almost immaterial.
In this first extract of our exclusive interview, Baba Ahmed tells us why he pleaded guilty to terrorism offences and whether he considers himself a terrorist.
You pleaded guilty in the States to providing material support for terrorism and conspiring to provide material support for terrorism. And what that means is funds, personnel and equipment for the Taliban. And as the judge said, it was not about you planning a terrorist attack. It was about you giving support via a website to the Taliban at the time that they were protecting Osama bin Laden before he carried out the 9/11 attacks. It means you're a convicted terrorist. Is that how you view yourself?
The judge, one of the most senior judges in America who sentenced me, Judge Janet Hall, after seeing all the evidence in my case, she said, this man is not a terrorist. At the time I pleaded guilty, I'd been in prison for 9.5 years without trial. I'd been in solitary confinement for about just over a year. The prosecutors offered me a deal. They said, hey, plead guilty and you'll be back in England within a year. So I said, where do I sign?
So how do you view yourself?
Well, I view myself in the way that the judge described me. She said, he's a good person, he's not a risk to anyone, and more importantly, this man is not a terrorist. So, I mean, other people are entitled to their opinion about me, but people who know me, and the judge who saw the evidence against me, she came to the right conclusion.
She also said what you did was very serious. It's not the most serious crime that can be committed. But you can't walk away from the fact that what you were doing was enabling Osama bin Laden to be protected in Afghanistan and to train the men who actually boarded the flights that drove into the Pentagon and the World Trade Center. You were both, by your voice and by what you were asking people to do, encouraging the Taliban to protect bin Laden and indeed to fight against the United States who were trying to get bin Laden.
She also went on...
But do you accept that?
She did make that statement, yes.
Do you accept that?
She also went on to say that Mr. Ahmed was never believed in or supported the views of Al-Qaeda or Osama bin Laden. So it was sort of like by advocating support for the Taliban, who at that time had, due to their failure to hand over bin Laden to the United States, then in effect that's what was happening.
So you accept that then?
Well, not knowingly, because at that time I didn't really know what bin Laden was about, but technically, yes, that's what was happening at that time, that the Taliban, due to their failure to hand over bin Laden, and it wasn't known at the time, and I didn't know at the time that 9/11 is being planned and what bin Laden is really up to. So my support, my advocating support of the Taliban was to help establish an Islamic society, but I do accept that with hindsight, that was naive of me to do so. The situation there was complicated. I did it in good faith, but in hindsight, I regret doing that, and it was naive of me to do that, because it was a complicated situation.
To be clear then, you regret supporting the Taliban back then?
Yes,
2001.
Yes.
Why did you support them?
I think during the 1990s, the late 1990s, after my experiences in Bosnia, after meeting survivors from the Srebrenica massacre, I think what the United Nations did at Srebrenica, there was a sense of, we have to protect ourselves, and if we don't protect ourselves, no one is going to protect us, you know.
So your experiences then, were they crucial in terms of the motivation for the setting up of the Azam websites?
Yes, absolutely. Because what I saw in Bosnia, and at the end of the war in Bosnia, then I lost a lot of friends who died fighting to protect the Bosnian people. And I considered them heroes. I still consider them heroes. And I wanted the world to know about them. And so we made a series of audio cassettes and books talking about their stories and what happened there.
With the ultimate aim of doing what?
Just preserving their legacy, just telling the world about these heroes, these great men who went and left their own lives behind in order to help bring life to other people.
In 2001, an article was posted on one of the websites calling for financial support for the Taliban government in Afghanistan. You know, what you can do to help the Taliban mm-hmm. was the headline.
Yeah.
And it talked about how people could effectively send $20,000 mm-hmm. to them and how to get it to them and so on.
Yeah.
You didn't post that article. Mm-hmm. Did you feel a responsibility for it being on the website, though?
Yes, because I was the founder of the website. So even though I didn't post that article, but as the founder of it, I accepted criminal responsibility for it in the United States. And that, together with another article, was the sum total for which I pleaded guilty. That was my offence. Mm.
And did you agree with that article, what you can do to help the Taliban?
At the time, yes. Mm.
The article called for people to send equipment to the Taliban, military suits, gas masks. Mm-hmm. Did you agree with that?
Yes. At the time, there was a risk that there might be an invasion of Afghanistan. This is all happening way before 9/11.
Yes.
So the Taliban at that time, they are a government with three embassies. They're recognized by three countries around the world. And they're involved in a civil conflict with the Northern Alliance warlords. So at that time, it was feared that Russian troops might launch a chemical invasion of Afghanistan. And so the website published appeals calling for gas masks to be given to the Taliban to help defend themselves against a chemical attack.
One of the articles was still on the website after 9/11, when uh-huh. it was clear that Al-Qaeda was responsible for 9/11.
There was 4,000 items of content that went on the websites. So obviously, you know, a lot of them, they stayed on for way after. I mean, it's easy to put everything in the context of 9/11, whereas out of 4,000 items of content on the website, 98% were about Bosnia and Chechnya. And then right at the end of the life of the website, there were these two articles supporting the Taliban, which, of course, I mean, it was, in hindsight, that decision to put those articles on the website and to advocate support for the Taliban, then I regret that. And that was, you know, it was naive at the time. With the hindsight of what was actually going on in Afghanistan at the time.
In late 2001, again after 9/11, Azam posted a farewell message. I'll read you a couple of quotes. "We believed the word of Osama bin Laden and the Taliban as Muslims when they say they had nothing to do with this terrorist attack, over and above the word of a lying disbeliever like Bush. If they did it, they would proudly say so, because they're not afraid of the reprisals from anyone." What did you think of those sentiments at the time?
I think here lies the naivety of taking people's words at face value. And strange and odd as it seems now, at the time, I never believed that bin Laden and Al-Qaeda were behind 9/11. They only accepted responsibility for it, I think it was about 4 years later, in 2005, where Bin Laden actually made a statement saying, yes, you know, we accept responsibility for that. So in a situation
so
like that,
much of the rest of the world knew it was Al Qaeda.
Well, I mean, knew there was assumptions, and me as a Muslim, who am I going to believe? Mm. You know, if I have to take sides, I mean, Bush said, you're either with us or you're against us. Mm. I'm not going to take Bush's side. So after that, it wasn't really about Al Qaeda. It was about this country, you know, the Taliban, they're being attacked. And if I'm going to take sides, then obviously I'm going to take their side.
Because
you know, it doesn't mean that I support Al Qaeda or Bin Laden, because of my experience in Bosnia, where here you have a Muslim nation that is attacked by a foreign invading army, then my sympathy would be with the Muslims, obviously.
Mm. How would you describe the Taliban now?
Well, I was wrong to advocate support for them, obviously.
You have always made it clear that you condemn 9/11. Do you understand why the American authorities might think otherwise?
They don't think otherwise. At the time they did. As hard as it is, I sort of get where the United States is coming from. They were angry. The case agent who investigated me, he told me so during the flight, during my extradition. He came and spoke to me, and he told me, he said, I lost 14 colleagues in 9/11. And as he said that, he looked at me in the eye, and he said, that's what's motivated me in my work. So inside I thought, what, someone did 9/11, so you're blaming me for it, you're coming after me. But when people are angry, they don't make rational decisions, they don't think rationally. So one of those irrational decisions was to think that somehow I had something to do with Al Qaeda or Bin Laden to come after me. And after 11 years, the judge declared that that was all nonsense. She rejected that, that I never supported Al Qaeda or Bin Laden or associated with them or advocated support for them at any time.
You were sentenced in 2014 to 12 and a half years in jail. Mm-hmm. The US authorities actually wanted a jail sentence of 25 years.
Yes.
How did you react to that sentence?
I didn't expect the judge to say the words that she did about me, that this is a good person who never meant any harm to anyone. He's not a terrorist. And it was a pleasant surprise. I mean, I knew that in my heart all along, but it was a surprise.
You have said a number of times, you're not a terrorist. You have quoted some of the judge's comments. Yes, she said you're a good person. Yes, she said she believed you posed no threat to the public, but that what you did was serious. Mm-hmm. Some of the things I mentioned earlier. You pleaded guilty to terrorism offences, two of them. Mm-hmm. Therefore, in the eyes of the law, you are a terrorist.
In the eyes of US law, not in the eyes of British law.
In the eyes of the US law?
Yeah, in the eyes of US law, of course, yeah, I pleaded guilty. As the judge said, pleading guilty to material support for terrorism doesn't make you a terrorist. There's a lot of people that are not even Muslim. Well, according to the laws of the United States, then I'm a convicted felon, to use legal parlance.
Is that semantics?
The last time I checked, British law applies in Britain. So absolutely, to make it clear, according to the laws of the United States, I am a convicted felon who pleaded guilty to providing material support to terrorists and conspiring to provide material support to terrorists. Of course, I accept that. But that makes no difference to me where I am now. The judge made that clear, and I think ultimately the judge's words is... You know, that's good enough for me.
It's as though you want it both ways. You pleaded guilty. Mm-hmm. It was a plea bargain, so you could effectively, you know, come home sooner, come back to Britain sooner, and now you're here. It's like that's irrelevant now.
Well, no. I want to make it clear. I have no regrets for pleading guilty in America. Pleading guilty in America, I think that was the best decision of my life because it allowed me to come home. So I'm not saying that now, oh, I shouldn't have pleaded guilty. No, according to the laws of the United States, I was guilty. And that's why I pleaded guilty.
Plenty of you getting in touch about this. We'll read as many comments as we can throughout the programme. Just a few for now. Gary on Facebook says, I actually think this man is brave to go against the Taliban. To come out in public and show your face is a feat within itself. He was wrong. I agree, he was wrong, putting it lightly. This shows the intelligence of Baba Ahmed to recognise it, unfortunately too late, as it was after he contributed to terrorist activity. Colin on Facebook says, well done for admitting he was wrong in supporting Islamist extremists. And Poonian on Facebook, one soon learns the value of liberty in a free society when the liberty is withdrawn for abusing the freedom bestowed upon you. Ian on Facebook, hang on a minute, this guy supported a terrorist organisation that was blowing our soldiers and citizens up, and now he's whinging because he had to wear a blindfold and it breached his human rights. Have I missed something here? You can see the full version of the interview, a one-hour version of the interview with Baba Ahmed on BBC News' YouTube page. And after 10, we'll hear his reaction to the growth of so-called Islamic State, a group which did not exist when he was first detained. Baba Ahmed wasn't paid a fee for his interview. In fact, we don't pay any of our interviewees. Still to come on the programme, we will talk to the mother of a 14-year-old boy murdered by a man, a teenager actually, he met online. The police force which handled the case has apologised unreservedly for the way it handled that case and agreed to pay compensation. And as the rise in sexually transmitted infections is blamed in part on oral sex, we'll ask if under 30s know enough about how to protect themselves against such infections. ...9.36, the main headlines so far this morning. Good morning. Turkish warplanes have hit Kurdish rebel targets in northern Iraq after that car bombing yesterday killed 37 people in the Turkish capital Ankara. The president has vowed to bring terror to its knees and said the attack would only strengthen the resolve of the country's security forces. Our reporter Shadi Al-Kashif is in Ankara. And the government clearly blaming the rebels for this attack. Has any one group yet claimed responsibility?
Not yet. Nobody hold the responsibility of this attack. We can also confirm that the investigation is still continue in here in Ankara. The police arrest about 14 persons as a suspicious of maybe they have links with this explosion. Here the security closed the area from more than 16 hours until now, and also earlier this morning the security put like a white barrier in the front of the area where is the explosion happened. We cannot see what exactly happened there, but all the information that we got until now from the security that the teams of investigation now trying to get more information about the IDs of the victims. Some sources talking about lady, maybe she's behind this attack, and all the information now that we got that they ask the family of this lady to get a test of the bloods to make a test of DNA to see if it's exactly the attackers. Also, we get information that the Prime Minister, the Turkish Prime Minister Ahmed Davutoglu, will visit the scene here after 1 hour, and we are expecting that he will be, you know, he promised to say today who's behind this attack, so everybody's waiting here this information.
Thank you, Shadi Al-Kashif in Ankara. Baba Ahmed, the former IT support worker from London who was jailed in the US for supporting the Taliban online, tells this programme that he was naive and regrets his actions. We'll bring you more of the interview throughout the programme. The party of the German Chancellor, Angela Merkel, has been defeated in 2 out of 3 states in regional elections in what's being seen as a sharp rebuke to her policy of welcoming large numbers of refugees. Chris Evans has apologised unreservedly after scenes for his new Top Gear series were filmed near the Cenotaph in central London. The scenes have been criticised as disrespectful to the armed forces. In the past few moments, a joint European and Russian rocket mission has successfully launched to Mars. A satellite will try and trace the source of methane in the planet's atmosphere. Those are the headlines and some sport now. Here is Jessica.
Yes, good morning, Victoria. Well, it was a packed weekend of sport, but where else to start but rugby and the Six Nations. Scotland beat France, which means England are the Six Nations champions for 2016. I'll get on to what that means for them and that incredible achievement in just a second, but let me tell you about Scotland, because it's the first time they've beaten France in a decade. Now, they conceded a try early on, the Scottish, and they really had to put a shift in to come back from that. A beautiful solo effort for one of their tries in the first half by Duncan Taylor. If you haven't seen that, please go to the BBC Sport website and watch that. He started his run from the inside his own half. A really incredible solo effort. But for England, it's their first title since 2011. Their new coach, Eddie Jones, has come in and won it at the first time of asking. And what a turnaround from the World Cup shambles that they experienced just a few months ago. But despite the England victory, it's been overshadowed somewhat by an England player, Joe Marler. He's been accused of using a racially derogatory term against Welsh player Samson Lee in relation to Lee's traveller community background. Now, he's yet to be cited, but we understand that Six Nations officials are investigating. We're going to look at that in more depth at 10 o'clock when I return. Now, elsewhere in sports, tennis, Rafa Nadal, the 14-time Grand Slam champion, says he's going to sue the former French minister for saying that his time off in 2012 was probably due to a positive doping test. Now, Nadal says he's heard many of these allegations against him before and he's let them go unchallenged in the past, but no more. So we'll hear from him and all that on the Six Nations when I come back just after 10 o'clock, Victoria.
Cheers, Jess. Thank you. Next this morning, there are warnings that unprotected oral sex is spreading more sexually transmitted infections than ever before. The British Association for Sexual Health and HIV has told Radio 1's Newsbeat that many under 30s don't know they can get infections like genital herpes, chlamydia and drug-resistant gonorrhea from oral sex. We're going to talk frankly now about oral sex, STIs and protection with Tyler John, who's a 20-year-old student in Leicester and works part-time for a sexual health organisation, and Dr. Peter Greenhouse, who's a sexual health consultant. He's in Bristol. And if you've got young children around, you might not want them to hear some of this conversation. Dr. Greenhouse, first of all, how can people protect themselves against contracting STIs through oral sex?
Well, there's an obvious way, and that's to either use condoms or fellatio, or to use use a dental dam for cunnilingus. But the unacceptability of these methods has been shown over many, many years. And actually, nowadays, the only people who meticulously use condoms for oral sex are female commercial sex workers. And so that's a problem for everybody else, because one of the main reasons we have drug-resistant gonorrhea is because the drugs don't penetrate the throat so well. So people need to be aware of that, and it's impossible to run a campaign because nobody's going to follow it, but you just have to know that infections can be passed on without you having a sore throat, for instance. So it's an important issue, and it's worth talking about.
Do you think people generally are aware they can use condoms to protect themselves when it comes to oral sex?
Well, I think most people, if they thought about it, could do, but in the heat of the moment, they may be very meticulous about using condoms for vaginal and anal penetration, if that's what they're doing, but very few people bother to use them for oral sex. Although it would dramatically reduce the risk of transmissions, a certain number of infections are passed this way. It's not the most important method of transmission, but it's certainly on the increase. What's important about it, of course, is that if you've got a faster rate of change of partner with dating apps, then you've got a greater risk of passing on infections, and you want to try and do something to reduce that.
Tyler, let me bring in you. How aware are you of the risk of STIs and also your university mates?
I like to think as a sex educator, I'm quite aware, because that's because I've had the opportunity to be exposed to information like this. I mean, and it's not the same. I obviously can't speak for everyone at a university environment because there's such a diverse range of people, but I do know people, I do have friends that aren't using contraception when they're having penetrative sex, and that's unfortunate. But as a sex educator, we don't like to blame people for the misconception that they might have, or for not using them, because we believe that there is something inherently wrong with the sex education system at the minute in this country.
Okay, so I'd like to think everyone knows what a condom is. Do you want to explain what a dental dam is?
Yeah, basically a dental dam is a piece of latex about this big, mm-hmm. and it's placed over the vaginal opening for oral sex. So it's there to protect against the spread. It's kind of like material, just like a condom. So it's kind of there to help against the spread of STIs that can be contracted from oral sex, which obviously a lot of people don't understand about. So,
Do you agree with Dr. Greenhouse when he says, you know, with the rise of dating apps, that people are having more sexual partners, therefore that could contribute to the rise of STIs?
Yeah, I definitely agree, because obviously if people are being exposed to situations where they're going to be having a lot more sex, and that's something that we tend to, like, as sex educators, we do tend to warn against, because, like, we always say, for every change of sexual partners, you should be going to your GP or your local sexual health clinic to be getting tested. You should be getting tested once a year.
Is anyone doing that?
We
every
like
time
to think
you change
so.
Your sexual partner,
we like
you
to think so. That's what we definitely encourage. But obviously, it'd be very ignorant of me to sit here and say, okay, all people that are engaging in sexual activity are going to get tested, because obviously with the data that's been released this morning, I'm not sure of the statistics, but if there is an increase in the spread of STIs through oral sex, then clearly that's not happening. It's because people aren't aware that a lot of people are under the misconception that you can't catch anything from that way, so...
Thank you very much, Tyler. Thank you very much for coming on the programme. Tyler John, thank you for your time as well, Dr. Peter Greenhouse. Many thanks. Still to come on the programme, we'll bring you more of our exclusive interview with Baba Ahmed, the British man jailed for supporting the Taliban, and more of your reaction to it. For example, he says, even if he knew nothing about 9/11, how could Baba Ahmed support the Taliban's attitude to citizens, especially to women? And Apayam says, respect the honesty of Baba Ahmed. No amount of money will bring my son back. The words of a mother whose 14-year-old boy was murdered by a man he met online. Breck Bednar was killed in 2014 after going to the home of Lewis Daines, who was then 18, who he'd met online. This was the phone call that Daines made to the police after he'd killed Breck Bednar. The details are upsetting.
Essex Place Emergency.
Hi there. Hello. I need police and a forensics team to my address, please.
What do you mean? What's happened?
My friend and I got into an altercation, and I'm the only one who came out alive.
Are you telling me you've killed somebody?
Yes, I am.
Daines is now serving life for Breck's murder with a minimum of 25 years. Weeks before the boy was killed, his mother, Lauren Lefebvre, had called the police with concerns about his relationship with Daines. She thought he was being groomed. They did nothing. And an investigation later found Surrey police failed to deal with her properly, and that call centre staff his mother spoke to lacked knowledge. The force has now unreservedly apologised, accepted mistakes were made, and paid the family an undisclosed amount of compensation. And we can talk to Lauren Lefebvre now. Thank you very much for coming on the programme again.
And
do explain, for those who aren't aware of the details, how Surrey police failed to protect your son.
Well, I felt Breck was being groomed, and it had been over a matter of months. His personality had changed, his ideology was changing, and I felt that he was being brainwashed. So I did what I thought was the most highest important thing you could do, and I went to the police and I told them in my phone call my concerns about Breck and some of the stories, like the predator had said he had given $2 million in Bitcoin trades to the Syrian rebels, and you know, stories that he had worked for the US government and then he lived in New York and had this amazing undercover career, and how I felt that he was grooming the boys, Breck in particular. And I was told that police intelligence would be checked. I was told that three times. Five times I mentioned Breck was being groomed. So when I hung up the phone, I felt a false sense of security that this person would be checked out, because I did feel that he was a dangerous predator. Mm.
Surrey police, as I said in the introduction, clearly accept that mistakes have been made. They unreservedly apologise. They released that in a statement yesterday. Have they apologised to you?
They did try to make an appointment with me, and it literally coincided with the release of Daines' second tweet to me. So I had to cancel the appointment to deal with police on that issue instead. I don't know exactly who is supposed to apologize because it's such a big entity. You know, it's quite formal and it's not face to face at this point. So,
do you want that? Do you need that?
I don't know, because really it comes down to the people who've left and resigned that were going to get misconduct charges, and also their supervisors and people who are running the department. So it is a big entity in itself. I think it's just nice to be past that, have this stepping stone, tick it off the list of this horrible tragedy rite of passage and move forward with the Breck Foundation.
Mm. Why was it important for you to pursue damages?
What we wanted at the beginning was to find out what really happened, because at the beginning we didn't know if either Essex had failed to put Danes into the system because he was known to the police.
That's prior. Where he lived, and that's yes. Where your son, he travelled to his home.
That's
in Grays.
Right, and he was known to the police for prior allegations of rape against a 15-year-old boy, as well as having indecent images of children on his computer and hacking his school computer. So he was known to the police, and we wanted to get to the bottom of where in the chain of, you know, of investigation was this, you know, failing. Mm. So the IPCC did investigate both forces. Unfortunately, we had to fight to have those be in independent investigations, because the last thing we wanted was for the forces to investigate themselves and not look thoroughly enough. And that's why we had to fight to get independent investigations.
Mm. Can I ask you how much compensation you've received?
We're not allowed to discuss any of the you know, details of the settlement. It's you know, of course there's nothing that'll bring Breck back, you know, a public apology or anything. It's just sort of another step to move forward.
You mentioned the call handler resigned, the supervisor resigned. It meant, amongst other things, as you said, they avoided misconduct charges. We're just going to play some of your phone call, your initial phone call to Surrey Police, so our audience can hear it. We don't identify the call handler, and it's been edited. Let's have a listen.
Good evening, Surrey Police. How can I help?
Yes, I have a 14-year-old son, and there's an 18-year-old unknown, well, he says he's an 18-year-old person, and I feel like he's being groomed. He's being turned against his family and schooling, and it's been ongoing for a while, and I'm getting really concerned that this person isn't actually who he says he is.
What sort of concerns do you have then? I mean, obviously there's that age difference, but what is he saying?
He's trying to turn him against everything. He's talking about government. He's anti-government, and he said he worked for the U.S. government and quit because he's anti-government. He said he's given £2 million to Syria because of their crisis. He's against Christianity. He's told my son that he shouldn't be obligated to go to church even once a month, that he doesn't need to go and shouldn't go. So there's religious elements, government elements, and he's grooming him for something because he's trying to change his thinking set on everything.
Well, Surrey Police say they accept mistakes were made in how Ms. Lefebvre's telephone call to them was handled and responded to, and unreservedly apologise for what happened. As part of the settlement, Surrey Police have agreed to implement recommended changes to their procedures to ensure that other children like Breck are protected. Your call in total lasted for just under 12 minutes. The call handler said they didn't recall having any training specifically on grooming, and a new procedure since your son's death has been put in place to help make sure that child sexual exploitation is recognised at that call handling stage. Then it will be escalated to an intelligence officer and then a duty inspector. Plus, they've got a template now for what questions to ask someone like you who might call them with concerns about grooming. Is that enough?
I think it's a start. We need to make sure that this is maintained. And the problem with any sort of position like this, you know, it's high stress, it's shift work, long hours, retention is difficult. So, you know, what training's done this year will need to be done on a regular basis, because, you know, there's new people constantly coming in. People don't understand that boys can be groomed just as much as girls. Any child has a vulnerability. And because there was no sexting or no sexual messages, I think that also made the call handler and the call closer because they're both at fault. The call closer could have said, "Where's the PNC check?" or, you know,
the police national computer.
Yes, yeah. And neither of them, you know, even made an effort to do this simple, simple check. So it is a lot of training, but that won't, you know, it's not just a one-off. It has to be ongoing, and not just for Surrey, for police forces all over the country.
Indeed. And again, you did mention it earlier, but had they checked the police national computer, that's when they would have found a previous allegation had been made against Danes back in 2011. You mentioned you believed you'd had a tweet from Danes recently. In fact, you believe you've had two online messages from him. The prison service say they searched his cell and they found nothing that he could have used to send that. The police are investigating. Where are they up to in that? And why do you believe it's him?
Well, I literally just got a message today that they have found a lead, but they can't tell me what it is. It's very difficult because he is very techno-savvy. So he's got it going to different ISP addresses. Google and Twitter, unfortunately, won't cooperate. They say he has a right to freedom of speech, which makes me completely shocked that a convicted, admitted murderer is allowed these rights to harass, slander, libel the mother of the victim. So we're waiting for investigations, but it's very difficult. So we need our police trained, cyber trained, so that they can catch up with the criminals and be able to be more savvy than them. And that's the problem right now.
Thank you very much for coming on the programme. Thank you for talking to us. Thank you, Oren Lefebvre. Still to come in the next hour of the programme, an apology from Chris Evans over scenes that were filmed for his new Top Gear series near the Cenotaph in central London. Plus, we'll play you more of the interview with Baba Ahmed, the British man jailed for supporting the Taliban online. That's just after 10 o'clock. Many of you getting in touch about the first part of the interview, which we played just after 9:15. Pamela on Facebook. I know there have been things I have believed in very passionately, only to find out I was so wrong to support them. Richard on Facebook, once a traitor, always a traitor. Jack on Facebook, people are only sorry when they get caught. Not sorry for what they did, but sorry they got caught. And this email from John, great to hear the interview. Thought-provoking. I think Americans that think because Baba Ahmed supported resourcing the Taliban that he is a terrorist should revisit their own history of funding the IRA for years. That makes every one of the US supporters of terrorists. Do keep those coming in. You can email victoria@bbc.co.uk or you can send us a message on Twitter using the hashtag VictoriaLive. Time for the latest weather now, just before 10 o'clock. Here's Stav.
Thank you, Victoria. Well, you don't think you need me to tell you what a lovely weekend it was. We had lots of sunshine around. We've got so many Weather Watcher pictures as well. This is a glorious one from Mudderford in Dorset. Clear blue skies there. You notice though people wearing their jackets on the beach there. It did have a bit of a nip to it, the temperature. And I wouldn't have wanted to put my foot in the sea either with temperatures around 9 degrees there. But lots of sunshine around. That's because we had high pressure dominating. And for the rest of this week, it looks like the high pressure will be dominating the scene. Lots of dry weather to come, mainly dry, I should say. We could see a little bit of light rain around the middle part of the week where cloud is thick enough. Cloud amounts and sunshine amounts will vary from day to day, and nights will continue to be chilly. But here's our huge area of high pressure, which is dominating the scene there, anchored across the North Sea. You'll notice here fairly tightly packed isobars to the south, and that's been developing a pretty nagging cold easterly breeze across southern areas. We had that over the weekend, taking the edge off the temperatures, and we're going to continue to see that pretty much throughout this week. So temperatures, once that cloud burns away this morning, will reach around 9, maybe 10 Celsius, lots of sunshine around. So if you get out of that breeze in that sunshine, fairly strong mid-March sunshine, it's going to feel very pleasant. But you can see the map is pretty much lit golden by sunshine. That's how it's going to be pretty much everywhere. I think the best of the temperatures, western parts of Northern Ireland, northern and western parts of Scotland, with some shelter from the easterly breeze there with all that sunshine continuing. So that's how it's looking through the afternoon. Into the evening period, many places will have a lovely end to the day. But then further west, under clear skies with light winds, temperatures will begin to fall away and we'll start to see some low cloud mist rolling in off the North Sea towards eastern areas. Don't be surprised if you see temperatures dipping below freezing central southern Wales and in towards the glens of Scotland as well. But closer to the east coast with the cloud, shouldn't be quite as cold. So we start Tuesday off on a chilly note across the west, maybe some mist and fog which will burn away. And I think we have an definite east-west split through Tuesday with central eastern areas holding on to the cloud. Parts of western Scotland, though, with some shelter in the sunshine, we could make 17 Celsius there. We'll have to watch that space for that. Maybe 15 Celsius for Northern Ireland. But eastern Scotland will see low cloud and a ha rolling in off the North Sea. So here quite chilly and grey, as will central and eastern parts of England. But further west, certainly western Wales and the southwest of England, again, the best of the sunshine here. So feeling quite warm where we have that sunshine, but certainly cooler across eastern areas where we hold on to the breeze and the cloud. For Wednesday, some of that cloud may be thick enough for the odd spot of light rain or drizzle through central eastern parts. We could see more sunshine, though, pushing in towards the south of the country, as well as the northwest corner of the UK seeing sunshine. And then into the latter part of the week, our area of high pressure drifts a bit northwards and westwards, allowing slightly northerly winds to move in from the north there, bringing in slightly cooler air. So I think it looks like it's going to turn cooler towards the end of the week. But high pressure still dominates, so it's set to stay fine and dry. That's your forecast.
Good morning, it's Monday, it's 10 o'clock. I'm Victoria Derbyshire. Welcome to our programme. In an exclusive interview, a British man jailed in the US for supporting the Taliban online tells us he was naive and regrets his actions.
My advocating support of the Taliban was to help establish an Islamic society, but I do accept that with hindsight that was naive of me to do so. The situation there was complicated.
Baba Ahmed also tells us so-called Islamic State are alien to his heritage and beliefs and talks for the first time about his relationship with Labour's London mayoral candidate Sadiq Khan. Watch the full interview throughout the programme this morning. Also, Turkish warplanes have hit Kurdish rebel targets in northern Iraq after a car bomb exploded in the Turkish capital of Ankara yesterday, killing 37 people. We'll talk to people who are in the capital this morning. Plus, Chris Evans has apologised unreservedly after scenes for his new Top Gear series were filmed near the Cenotaph in central London. And after the tragedy of the Germanwings flight that was deliberately crashed into the French Alps almost a year ago, we'll speak to the father of one of three British people killed. He's calling for changes to mental health care for pilots. Good morning. The main BBC news so far this morning. Turkish warplanes have struck Kurdish rebel targets in northern Iraq after that car bomb killed 37 people in the Turkish capital yesterday. The president has vowed to bring terrorism to its knees, and Turkey is blaming the Kurdish separatist group, the PKK, for the attack. Baba Ahmed, the former IT support worker from London who was jailed in the US for supporting the Taliban online, tells this programme exclusively that he was naive and regrets his actions. We'll bring you more of the interview through the programme. The party of the German Chancellor, Angela Merkel, has been defeated in two out of three states in regional elections, in what's being seen as a sharp rebuke to its policy of welcoming large numbers of refugees. Chris Evans has apologised unreservedly after scenes for the new Top Gear were filmed near the Cenotaph in central London. The scenes have been criticised as disrespectful to the armed forces. We'll bring you reaction. In the last half hour, a joint European and Russian rocket mission has successfully launched to Mars. A satellite will try and trace the source of methane gas in the planet's atmosphere. Those are the main news stories so far this morning. Here's Jess with the sport.
Yes, hello again, Victoria. Well, England were crowned Six Nations champions yesterday. They weren't even on the pitch. All the hard work was done by Scotland. They beat France for the first time in a decade at Murrayfield, which means England are Six Nations champions. And they've done it with a game to spare. And they haven't won the title since 2011. England next play France next weekend, and a victory would give them 5 wins out of 5.
It's obviously nice to win the championship. But I think as a team, we feel we haven't achieved what we want to achieve yet, and that's the Grand Slam.
I know you just bumped into Dylan Hartley. What did he have to say to you?
Yeah, well, we didn't know whether to shake hands, give each other a hug, or just get on with business. So we shook hands, just decided what we're going to do tonight and decided what we'll do for the rest of the week.
We keep the same group of players. They can win the tournament during many years because they're very, very, very young, very experienced. They got some quality. They're very well organised. And Eddie Jones brings this confidence.
Now, that English victory over Wales on Saturday wasn't without controversy, though. England's Joe Marler has apologised to Wales prop Samson Lee for allegedly calling him a gypsy boy. Now, just take a listen to this.
Bob, don't put yourself in the way of the halter.
You can hear the words are pretty clear to hear. We can now speak to our rugby reporter, Chris Jones. And Chris, what do you think the fallout is likely to be from this?
Well, the Six Nations authorities are investigating this, Jess. It's an unprecedented case, really, so they're taking their time to collate all the evidence. As you say, Joe Marler apologised to Samson Lee at half-time of the game. Lee has spoken quite openly in the past about his Romani heritage. England coach Eddie Jones also gave Marler a dressing down and reminded him of his responsibilities as an England player. The RFU released a statement. The WRU released a statement in turn saying they were disappointed by the comment. But the Six Nations authorities may still act. This falls under Regulation 1710.4, verbal abuse of players based on religion, race, colour, national or ethnic origin, sexual orientation or otherwise. The entry point for an offence of this kind, i.e. the lower end sanction, is 4 weeks. So if Marler is cited, and we might find out more today, if he is cited and if he is found guilty, then he could be facing a ban and will miss the England game against France this weekend in Paris.
Chris, thank you very much for joining us. We'll give you the latest on that when we have it. On to tennis now. And the 14-time Grand Slam champion Rafa Nadal says he'll sue former French government minister who claimed his seven-month absence from tennis in 2012 was probably due to a positive doping test. Now, Nadal claims he's let these type of allegations go unchallenged in the past. But the latest comments from Roselyne Bachelot, who was once Minister for Health and Sport, cannot be ignored.
To listen, to hear that comments from a person that should be serious because was a minister of a big country and a great country like France. So I'm gonna sue her, and I'm gonna sue everyone who gonna comment something similar in the future because I am tired of that.
Well, strong words there from Nadal, but it doesn't seem to be affecting his tennis at the moment. He's through to the third round at Indian Wells, but that is all the sport for now. I'll have the headlines at 10:30, Victoria.
Thank you, Jess. Back to our main story this morning. A British IT support worker jailed over a website considered to be a key moment in the birth of internet jihad claims he was hooded by the Metropolitan Police, a practice that breaches Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights. Baba Ahmed pleaded guilty to two counts of providing material support to terrorism and was sentenced to 12 and a half years in jail. The 41-year-old had fought a record eight-year-long campaign against extradition to the United States. Two articles posted on a website he founded called Azam urged Muslims to send money and equipment to the Taliban, who at the time were harbouring Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. The offences were committed in the UK, but US authorities argued that because the website was hosted on a US server, it made its content subject to American law. In his first TV interview since his release from a high-security jail in the States 8 months ago, Baba Ahmed tells us he was naive to support the Taliban and now regrets his actions. He alleges MI5 have tried to recruit him several times since he got back to Britain. He says he wants to stop young Muslims being attracted to extremism and calls for an apology from the Met Police over his treatment over the last 12 years. In this second part of the interview, he tells us about the time he spent in a high-security jail in the States and that he believes so-called Islamic State are alien to his heritage and beliefs.
I wonder, when you look back at the websites now, do you acknowledge that the Azam websites were effectively the kind of the start of cyber jihadism, that the kind of images, the kind of postings have now been adopted and are used in a very different way, perhaps even, you know, much more gruesome way, a more sophisticated way, by groups like so-called Islamic State?
I don't think so, because the Azam websites were predominantly focused on the conflicts of what was happening in Bosnia and Chechnya, where foreign invading armies had invaded a Muslim country and they were killing civilians. What's happening today is that people are killing civilians and then they're filming it and putting it on TV. So it's like the complete opposite of what the Azam website stood for.
There's no link at all?
No, of course not. Of course not, no.
One of the tapes that your website hosted and you narrated was called In the Heart of the Green Birds, and it had stories, as mm-hmm. you've just explained, of battles in Bosnia, people who were killed. Mm-hmm. Years later, that tape was found in possession of some of the London 7/7 bombers. Mm-hmm. And Even now, there are quotes from that cassette in social media posts from British men fighting for so-called Islamic State.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of that?
I think ultimately I'll say what David Cameron said. He said the responsibility of those who murder innocent people lies with them themselves. I mean, I've heard that this cassette, they had, some of the London bombers had this cassette. I've also heard that there was articles from the BBC News website found on their computers, for example. I mean, we don't know. We can't say what actually was their reason or their motivation. But to say that someone hears a tape about heroes who gave their lives protecting innocent people in Bosnia, and then they use that as a motivation to killing innocent people on the streets of London, you need quite a lot of mental gymnastics to get from there to there.
What would you say to young British Muslim men and women who, like you did 20 years ago, felt really angry about the way some Muslims were being treated in parts of the world?
I felt outraged, not angry. There's a difference. It's not a crime to feel outraged at injustice, what's happening. But ultimately, we are responsible for our actions. And it's important that before people decide to take a course of action, before you translate your outrage into action, think deeply and carefully about what you are doing, and don't allow yourselves to be a pawn. Don't allow yourselves to be used by other people. Don't let anyone bully you that the only way to paradise is by bringing misery upon innocent people who have done nothing to you. Make your own mind up. Be smart, be intelligent, do your research, and make your own mind up. That's what I'll say to them.
And what if those young people make their own mind up and think, actually, yeah, I am going to go and join Islamic State?
Well, I mean, if that's what they're going to do, as long as they understand the risks that they're taking to their own lives, they could end up in prison, they could end up disabled. I mean, war is no joke. And I've been in war, and I've been on battlefields. And no one should be under any illusion that war is some kind of glorified thing that you see in a video with the, you know, with music in the background, and it's all going to be, you know, nice and good. So before you decide to put yourself into that situation where, okay, if you're killed, you might be lucky. You might lose your eyesight, you might be disabled, you may be caught in, you may be imprisoned and tortured to death. Something might happen to members of your family. These are real risks. And sometimes in people's eagerness to want to do something, they fail to understand the risks of what they're actually getting themselves into. And I think it's important that people do that.
Mm. Would you be emphatic and say, don't go and join Islamic State?
I would be emphatic in saying that foreign conflicts are complicated, and do not go and join a conflict, or do not go and join a group of people for whom there is no popular support. I'd be pretty emphatic in saying that.
How would you describe so-called Islamic State?
From what I've heard, getting people, getting journalists and cutting their heads off on TV, I don't recognize this. This is alien to me. I mean, jihad is something to be in Islamic history and heritage and beliefs. It's a noble act that's meant to protect and defend innocent people from acts of terror. And when terror and misery is brought to people under the label of jihad, it's not jihad, it's God knows what it is, but no God tolerates terror and misery being brought to innocent people on behalf of some sort of cause.
Some people might see what happened to you, held for 8 years in the UK without trial before being extradited to the States, as a reason to be outraged. What would you say to them?
It's good to be outraged. So the problem is not just outrage. And it's not just people in the Muslim community that were outraged over what happened to me. The problem is, what do you do with that outrage? So, yes, bad things happen to me, but good things also happen to me as well. Mm. And there was a balance in the way that I was treated, and I was mistreated, and I was treated very bad. But ultimately, I received some semblance of justice in the United States.
You spent 8 years fighting extradition to the United States. You argued that you should be tried in a UK court. If you had been tried in Britain instead of the States, would you have pleaded not guilty?
Absolutely. If I had been put on trial in this country, as I was asking for 8 years, I absolutely would have pleaded not guilty, and I would have gone to trial, because at most I was facing a sentence of about 2 years, of which I would do half if I was found guilty. I, during the Supermax prison in America for 2 years, I lived through complete hell, and those 2 years were the darkest years of my life. Every minute of every day, from the moment you wake up to the moment you go to sleep, was a struggle, was a battle, if you can sleep, that is. I saw one suicide attempt a week, three suicide attempts in one day, inmates who'd gone crazy and they would just bang the doors and shout and scream all day and all night. And at that point, I've been in prison 9.5 years without trial. I'm far away from home in a foreign country. And prosecutors come to me, they said, hey, plead guilty and you'll be home within the year. So any person in their right mind would just sign the dotted line, and that's exactly what I did. I don't regret pleading guilty. Pleading guilty, I want to make it clear, I'm not taking that back. It was the best decision of my life, and I'm proud I made that decision. But, you know, at that time, I didn't care what anyone thought of me. I just wanted to get back to my family. And here I am, so I'm glad I made the right decision.
Talk to us about 2 years solitary confinement. Describe what that actually means in practical terms, first of all.
It means you're in your cell for 23 to 24 hours a day by yourself. You're let out for an hour in an underground pit, underground concrete pit, where you can't see into the distance. If something is bothering you, you can't talk to anyone, you can't text anyone, you can't, you know, shout at anyone. You just have to be alone with your thoughts and toss and turn till the morning. How I would talk to other inmates is through the sink. I would get a toilet roll cardboard insert, and you blow the water out from the sink, and then one person listens and the other person speaks. For me to go to sleep, it would take me 5 pairs of socks and an empty shampoo bottle because of the noise. I would get the pairs of socks and, using a plastic spork, squeeze it in through the gaps all over the door. And then there was a vent that would blow air from the bottom. And if you balance the shampoo bottle at the right angle with some books, it would generate like a white noise, like a zzzz. And your brain can cut that out, and that drowns out the banging that's all around you. But then 3-4 times in the night, you'd wake up when the shampoo bottle falls, and the banging will wake you up. For 2 years, I never got a full night's sleep. So I remember there was an inmate next to me, and he tried to commit suicide. There was blood all over his cell. It was like a centimeter deep. And going past the cell, there was so much blood in there, it smelled like a butcher's shop. After I got back, I entered a butcher's shop, and straight away it took me to that memory of the blood in that cell. Even now, when I go into a butcher's shop, I can smell that blood. So those were very dark years, and I won't lie to you to try to somehow embellish it. Those were the darkest years of my life. And during that period, I would have done absolutely anything to get the hell out of that place and to get home. And I'm glad I made the right decision and I'm home.
What has that kind of experience done to your mind?
I've been getting help, professional help.
For?
For trauma treatment to basically help me deal with 6 years in isolation, including 2 years in solitary confinement. So I'm in a better position now than I was when I got home 7 months ago. I've calmed down a lot. I'm able to sleep better. I'm a bit less vigilant of my surroundings. I'm a bit less anxious. But I think it's made me. I think it's made me a stronger person.
Do you have post-traumatic stress disorder as a result of those experiences?
Yes.
And the counselling is helping?
The trauma treatment has helped, yes. I've been doing it for several months now, and it has helped. Most of the PTSD was arising from what the police did to me back in 2003. And being in isolation for several years, including solitary confinement, it actually aggravated that. But the treatment has helped a great deal, yes.
What are your thoughts towards the US authorities now, then?
I'm obviously not happy about what they did to me, but I'm not angry or bitter over what they did to me. And I remember a line that Nelson Mandela said when he walked towards the prison gate when he was released. He said, "I knew that if I did not leave my bitterness and hatred behind, then I would still be in prison." So the Americans released me, but I've also released them. If that makes sense.
Mm. When you were extradited to the States, you were hooded, I understand, as you were led to the plane.
Yes.
Why?
I don't know. When I got to the Royal Air Force Base, it was actually Metropolitan Police officers that first applied blacked out ski mask and earmuffs to me before I left the police van. And the officer came back and he said, "I'm sorry, mate, but we need to put these on you." And I remember saying to him that, "Officer, you know you're not allowed to do this. Blindfolding is banned in Europe. You're not allowed to do this." And he said, "I'm really sorry, it's the Americans, and you know, that's the way they want it done, so that's how we have to do it." So he was scared. The police, the Metropolitan Police officers were scared.
Of what?
Of the Americans. And this is in a Royal Air Force base somewhere in the east of England. So they put these blacked out ski mask goggles on me and these earmuffs, and then led me with handcuffs to this building. And then thereafter, I was handed over to the Americans. And then the Americans did the same. They blindfolded me and put earmuffs on me and put me in full shackles before they led me to the private jet. And I stayed like that for the first hour of the flight. And when I landed, I think an hour or two when I landed, they put me back in blindfolds and earmuffs. Why did they do that? I don't know. But after I complained to the British consulate in Boston, they contacted the Foreign Office, and the Foreign Office contacted the United States government, and they stopped doing that. I think the next person who was extradited after me, they didn't blindfold him.
Now you're back, I wonder if you think you are being monitored by MI5?
I hope not. I mean, I think MI5 is, they've got a lot more things on their plate than to be following me or monitoring me. They've tried to call me a few times, ask me if I'm interested in working for them. And I've told them I'm not a rat. That's not who I am.
So, since you've been back, they've called you?
Since I've been back, yeah, a few times. They've
How
always
many times?
Been about three times they've called me. They haven't been aggressive. They've been polite and courteous to me. And they've asked me, and they've respected my decision that I do not wish to work for them and I do not wish to meet them. So
you said you wouldn't do it because you're not a rat. What do you mean?
I'm not. That's not who I am. I'm not a spy and informant who goes into communities and hears things and goes and tells other people about it. You know, most people in the world are not like that. And, you know, the intelligence services, they occupy a dark world. And I think it changes them as people. They become, some of them become dark people because of the work that they do. And I have no desire to be part of that world.
Many, many people supported your wish, your desire to be tried here in the UK. What did you think of that level of support?
I received over 10,000 letters from members of the public who shared their lives with me and gave me hope. 150,000 people signed a petition calling for me to be put on trial in this country. I think those people are heroes because I had no choice but to try and survive my ordeal, but every single one of them had a choice and they did not have to support me. And they went out of their way to support me, so I'm touched by that.
Why are you speaking to us today?
I wanted to share my experience, and I didn't want to do it as soon as I got back. Last 6 or 7 months now, I think I'm sort of ready to start talking about my experience, and I feel I have a message that perhaps some people may want to hear and some might benefit from them.
Thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you, you're welcome.
In the last half hour of the programme, Baba Ahmed will tell us about his relationship with Labour's London mayoral candidate Sadiq Khan. Thanks for all your messages, and there are many of them. Peter on Facebook, naive? No, stupid. Perhaps he now values the opportunities in the UK that he took for granted before. How could he have been unaware of the restrictions that the Taliban placed on ordinary Afghans? On Facebook too, Abby says, if he genuinely means what he's saying, then I'd say we all make mistakes, but you can't blame people for doubting him. This tweet from Abu, yes, he was naive to show support for the Taliban, but that was way before 9/11. So how can he be guilty and of what? He helped the oppressed in Bosnia and advocated for that support, and in Chechnya. Why hasn't Britain acknowledged that? This tweet from Raz, Baba Ahmed is a hero. He gave his life to defend the innocent people of Bosnia. JC on Facebook, why give this man more exposure? He should be jailed. Tweet from Paul, so much time devoted to a terrorist, so little time to disrespect. To our own armed forces. No bias by the BBC then? Shameful. Fahad on Facebook. Baba Ahmed's voice is much needed in today's world. Despite what he has been through, he has emerged unbitter and is just what is needed to build bridges between different communities at this critical juncture. And another one from Raza on Facebook. The treatment of Baba Ahmed by British security forces is nothing short of criminal. His only crime was to be a Muslim during the war on terror period. There must be justice. We need to ensure this never happens again. And as Baba Ahmed says, there needs to be an apology. You can watch the full 1 hour plus version of Baba Ahmed's interview on the BBC News YouTube page. We asked the Metropolitan Police for comment regarding Baba Ahmed's allegation of hooding by one of their officers. They told us no complaint regarding Mr. Ahmed's treatment during his extradition has been received by the Metropolitan Police Service. We approached MI5 about Baba Ahmed's claim that they tried to recruit him, but they had no comment to add. Chris Evans has apologised unreservedly after scenes for the new series of Top Gear were filmed near the Cenotaph in central London. He's also said the footage will definitely not be shown on the programme.
I think the images show are terrible. They look so disrespectful. There are mitigating circumstances, but absolutely no. Unreservedly apologise. You know, I saw the images this morning for the first time and I felt the same way as everybody else.
This isn't a good start for Top Gear, is it?
Well, Top Gear's already started as far as production is concerned. But no, this is not a good story, no.
Will the footage be used on air?
Of course, I don't know. I'm not responsible for that film, but I'm going to go and have a chat now and find out what's going on. That footage will definitely not go on air, no question about it.
And the Chancellor, George Osborne, also a little bit miffed off.
I don't know, because I didn't see that, because I was away with my family all weekend, so I didn't see it. I've seen the tweet this morning. I think that was more light-hearted than anything else.
Do you believe the footage shouldn't be aired?
Absolutely, 100%, yeah.
So you would pull the plug?
Well, that's not my decision, but if it was my decision, then I would say that particular scene shouldn't be shown. And I think that everybody will agree. I've talked to, before I went on the air this morning, because I saw the paper, I actually heard about it on Radio 4 this morning, first of all, and then I looked at the papers. And then I called Alex, the series producer, and then Alex called his superior, and then Matt called me as well. And, you know, we're all mortified by it, so absolutely 100% should not be shown.
So the message to the public is an apology?
Completely. I said it on the radio this morning. Unreserved.
Chris Evans, co-presenter Matt LeBlanc and a professional driver perform stunts near to the war memorial in Whitehall for the series.
Top Gear says the filming took place around 40 minutes away and with permission. Correspondent Mark Ashdown is here. What were they doing then?
Well, they've been filming for a while now for the new series of Top Gear, and this was Matt LeBlanc, his co-host, Chris Evans' co-host, filming yesterday right by the Cenotaph. They shut off the whole of Whitehall. And they were driving, him and a rally driver, were driving an 845-horsepower Unicorn Mustang. And what they were doing, not just driving up and down, I've not seen the filming, I have to say, but we're told they were performing donuts. Now, if you're not a rally fan, that's basically where you put the car, spin it round, pretty fast, loud, screechy tyres, lots of rubber marks all over the road as well. And it's led to a number of complaints, the most serious of which really articulated by former British military commander Colonel Richard Kemp. Now, he's accused them, the presenter and the show, of disrespecting the Cenotaph and Britain's war dead. He said it was a poor decision to use the 95-year-old war memorial as a backdrop for what he called a boy racer stunt. Now, it's worth noting Westminster Council, the programme, say, gave them permission to film, and they also say these pictures don't necessarily show exactly how close the filming was to the Cenotaph. But there were more complaints as well yesterday. Matt LeBlanc also filmed at St Paul's Cathedral. He gate-crashed a wedding there. The BBC had about 20 complaints yesterday. Bearing in mind, that's before these pictures were on the front pages of the newspapers. On a slightly lighter note, less serious at least, this is, of course, in Downing Street, outside number 10, number 11, George Osborne took to social media yesterday to complain about the noise, asking him to keep the noise down because I'm trying to work on the budget. But, of course, this other complaint about the Cenotaph is far more serious, and there are already calls for an inquiry into how this filming got permission and went ahead.
Well, Sarah tweeted us this morning. We can talk to her now. Hello, Sarah. How are you?
Hi. I'm absolutely outraged and disgusted, as are many people.
Even with Chris Evans's unreserved apology?
Well, absolutely. First of all, Matt LeBlanc should be the one who should be apologising. He shouldn't be hiding behind Chris Evans, who, you know, in defence of himself, he was away. And surely he should be able to rely on his co-presenters to do a professional job. And regards the vicinity of the Cenotaph, the fact is that the Cenotaph was there. And as I've said, the Cenotaph is actually interwoven into the very fabric of our society and our identity as the United Kingdom. And as an American who is one of our allies, you know, he should be really aware of this. I mean, he shouldn't actually need to have it pointed out. I marched at the Cenotaph, as do many people, fallen families, in November. And I can tell you that every day is Remembrance Day, but I had the honour of marching with some American families who lost their loved ones throughout different campaigns, and the respect that they showed and their eagerness to do what I was absolutely right, because they understood the importance of what this is. And the military, we are a family, and as a family we are disgusted.
You have also lost someone in Iraq?
Yes, I have. I lost my brother.
Which makes it clear why you're so passionate about this morning.
Well, I guess one could argue that I'm almost too close to the situation to be able to see it clearly. But take my brother aside for a moment. The Cenotaph, as I said, it you know, the very fabric, the very history, that one of the things that makes us great about being British is the help that we have given other countries and our belief in supporting and fighting for our country. And it says on the side of the Cenotaph, they died serving our country. We serve our country. So just as a general member of public, I'm disgusted.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Thanks for coming on the programme. A couple of more messages from others who've contacted us today. This email from Paul: I was looking forward to the new Top Gear with Chris Evans, but if the Ford Mustang driving around London is an indication of what's to come, I won't be watching the new series. Paul Rees says this is disrespect to our veterans. And this email from Michael: typical, more celebrity and large egos. Why do we continue to tolerate this? Thank you for those. Do keep them coming in. Thank you very much, Mark. Thank you. Still to come in the last half hour of the programme, we'll bring you more of the interview with Babar Ahmed, a British man jailed in the US for supporting the Taliban online. And after the German Wings plane crash almost exactly a year ago, in which a pilot deliberately killed 150 people, we'll speak to the father of one of three British victims who's calling for changes to mental health care for pilots.
10:34, the main news so far this morning. Turkey's president is vowing to bring terrorism to its knees after 37 people died in an attack in the capital, Ankara. Seventy people are being treated in hospital after the blast yesterday. A car packed with explosives was used to target people waiting at a bus stop in the capital. It's the third attack in the space of 5 months. This man saw what happened.
It came next to us. A second passed, and there was a woman behind us. Her seat just catapulted. Something hit my forehead. There was a car. The car exploded. The car, I think, was black. 5-6 people on board the bus died. I saw it. I ran away as fast as I could. Something hit my forehead and my shoulder. I don't remember anything else.
Well, this morning, Turkish jets have been bombing rebels in northern Iraq. Questions are now being asked about Turkey's ability to maintain security at a time when Europe needs Turkey's help to stem the flow of migrants passing through its borders from the conflict in Syria. Let's talk now to Enes Seneden from BBC Turkish. The third attack in Ankara, this is the latest one, yes. The third attack in recent time. Is there a growing sense that the authorities there can't stem this, can't stop this?
Yes, there are, for the last 5 months, exactly three attacks in Ankara only. And after each attack, we hear authorities, President Erdogan himself, coming out and saying things like he said yesterday, bringing out terrorism and bring it to its knees, mm-hmm. and so on. But so far, I mean, especially yesterday's attack was so gruesome because it was completely directed towards the civilian population. And it was an area packed with civilians who were trying to get back their homes. And this happened in the capital of the country and the powerhouse of the government. And obviously, it is creating a huge sense of insecurity in the country now.
Enes, thank you very much. Enes Seneden from BBC Turkish. Baba Ahmed, the former IT support worker from London who was jailed in the States for supporting the Taliban online, tells this programme that he was naive and regrets his actions. We'll bring you the final part of that interview in the next half hour of the programme. In the last hour, a joint European and Russian rocket mission has successfully launched to Mars. A satellite will try and trace the source of methane gas in the planet's atmosphere. Those are the main headlines. Here's the sport from Jessica.
Good morning again, Victoria. The sports headlines this morning. Scotland beat France for the first time in a decade, winning 29-18 at Murrayfield. The Scots came back from an early try against them to secure their first back-to-back Six Nations wins in 3 years. Now, England's Joe Marler has apologised to Wales prop Samson Lee for calling him a gypsy boy during Saturday's Six Nations match at Twickenham. He's yet to be cited, but officials are aware of the incident and say they're establishing the facts. 14-time Grand Slam champion Rafa Nadal says he will sue a former French minister for claiming that his seven-month layoff in 2012 was probably due to a positive doping test. Doesn't seem to be affecting his tennis, though. The Spaniard won through to the third round of Indian Wells last night. And FA Cup holders Arsenal have been knocked out of the competition by Watford, losing 2-1 at the Emirates. What a goal that was, by the way. It's the first time Watford have beaten Arsenal since 1988. That's all the sport for this morning.
Thank you very much. This morning, we've been bringing you an interview with Baba Ahmed, a 41-year-old British IT support worker who was jailed in America because a website he founded posted two articles in 2001 before the 9/11 attacks, encouraging people to raise cash, recruit fighters and send equipment to the Taliban at a time when they were harbouring Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. Baba Ahmed fought a record 8-year battle against extradition from Britain to the United States. His campaign was supported by his local MP, Sadiq Khan, who's now Labour's London mayoral candidate. Sadiq Khan's support of Baba Ahmed has been criticised by some, and Baba Ahmed has never commented on it before. At his sister's home, he wanted to show us a mosque he'd built from 25,000 matches whilst he was inside Long Larton Jail in Worcestershire while fighting extradition to the States.
I guess out of those 11 years in prison, this is where 1 year, 4 months of it went. Mm. It's made out of 25,000 matchsticks, and it was all glued together and sanded by hand. I mean, these grooves here, I got a pencil and I put sandpaper around them,
right.
And just made these like designs.
How many hours a day would you spend on this?
Sometimes maybe 6-7 hours a day, sometimes two hours a day, depending. I was also busy with fighting my case.
Mm-hmm. When you look at this now, now you're back home, you're free. What occurs to you in your mind?
It's memories of something that was, but happily, that memory, it had a good ending.
Tell us what you claimed happened when you arrested in December 2003.
It was early in the morning. My house was raided by about 15-20 police officers in riot gear. I stood up with my hands up, didn't offer any resistance. They grabbed me, put me on the floor, put me in handcuffs, and then they just proceeded to punch me all over my body. Punch me all over my head, my ears, back, kidneys. One of them, he put his hand through my legs, grabbed my genitals and pulled. And they took me downstairs. It's a room where we pray. And they put me in a prostration position. They started making comments about, are we allowed to wear our shoes in here? I got my shoes on. They're making sarcastic comments. Then they took me into the van to the police station. One of the officers, he struck me. He punched me on my back, on my kidney area, like about 10 or 12 times. This officer, he put me in this chokehold and he just held it there and I couldn't do anything. So I was down on my front and my hands were in cuffs. And he just held it there and then he let go. And then he did it again and I thought that I just need to ride it out. He held on, he held on, he held on, and I just felt that, you know, this guy's going to kill me, that I can't even say the Islamic Declaration of Faith before I die, and the situation is serious, this guy's going to kill me here in the back of this van. Then ultimately he let go and he said, you'll remember this day for the rest of your life, you effing bee.
You received £60,000 in compensation from the Met, and the then Met boss, Sir Paul Stevenson, said you were subjected to, quote, serious, gratuitous, prolonged, unjustified violence. The jury later cleared four officers. That jury heard audio recordings. The police argued that your injuries were self-inflicted, and ultimately the officers were found not guilty. Some members of the jury afterwards asked to shake the officers' hands. What did you think of that?
That was, I have to say, that was quite disheartening for them to go and shake the hands of the officers. I did lose some faith in humanity when that happened.
Do you want an apology from the police over your alleged treatment, including your claim that you were hooded?
The hooding, I just want an acknowledgement. The police and security services have an important job to do, but when they get things wrong, they should have the courage to apologise.
Do you trust the police?
After my experience, after what I've been through in the last 12 years, no.
The Metropolitan Police gave us this statement. Allegations of mistreatment were investigated, and subsequently in 2011, four officers were found not guilty of assault at a criminal trial when evidence that was not available during the civil proceedings was produced. The officers were also found to have no case to answer with regards to misconduct allegations. During the years that you were fighting extradition, your constituency MP, Labour's Sadiq Khan, who's running for Mayor of London, called for you to be tried in the UK, as did politicians from other parties. How much support have you had from him?
Sadiq Khan, he gave the same level of support to me that Zach Goldsmith and Boris Johnson said, which is basically that as a British citizen, accused of crimes committed in this country, I should be tried in this country.
Sadiq Khan visited you in Woodhill Prison in Milton Keynes in 2005 and 6. The conversations were monitored, they were bugged. Was he visiting you as a friend or constituency MP?
He was visiting me as a constituency MP. He, I think my family and lots of people in Tooting, here in Tooting, they told him to come and visit me, and he just came to visit me and just see how I was.
Do you consider him a friend?
Well, in my community, anyone who's not your enemy is a friend. So in that sense, he's a friend. But I've never socialised with him. I've never gone out to eat with him or, you know, going 10-pin bowling with him. So I'd rather say he's probably an acquaintance more than a friend. He's just someone that I knew. Mm.
How close were you before your arrest in December 2003?
I just see him walking. I mean, Tooting's a small community. I remember every Saturday he used to be standing at a stall for the Labour Party on Tooting High Street. If I'd see him, I'd just go up to him and shake his hand. So he's just someone that I knew that I would just see walking through the streets.
In an interview in the last few days, Sadiq Khan said about you, "We weren't close friends, but we knew each other growing up."
Yeah, that's accurate. I mean, he knew I was, and I mean, I was one, both of us are well known in Tooting for different reasons, of course. And Sadiq Khan, everyone in Tooting knows him.
Have you met him since you arrived back in Britain in the last few months from jail in the States?
Yeah, I was travelling home one night on the tube with my lawyer and just bumped into him. I shook his hand. And another time there was a funeral of someone in the community. I didn't really speak to him because he was like helping to carry the body. So yeah, I've just met him a couple of times since I came back.
And how did he react to you when you saw him on the tube?
Nothing. He's just, sure he's polite and courteous as always. I mean, I was with my lawyer, and you know, he met my lawyer as well. And then he got off. His stop came, and he got off at the next stop.
Let me read you some comments from you. This tweet from Vaishali: "I love your program, absolutely, but I don't understand why do you have to give publicity and valued time to people like Barbara Ahmed." This tweet from Evel: 8 years without trial or charge. That's British justice. It makes a mockery of British democracy. This tweet from Mo: "Incredible interview of Barbara Ahmed. 9.5 years in prison without charge. 2 years in solitary confinement." This tweet from Bri: "Barbara Ahmed, a convicted terrorist, is pulling the wool over the liberal media's eyes." You can watch the full 1 hour plus version of his interview on BBC News' YouTube page. A spokesperson for Sadiq Khan told us in his role as chair of the human rights group Liberty, Sadiq Khan campaigned against the unfair UK-US extradition treaty and for Barbara Ahmed to be tried in the UK. This was a campaign supported by MPs from all parties, including Boris Johnson and Zach Goldsmith. Right, plans to help low-paid workers save money are being set out by the Prime Minister, David Cameron. Let's talk to our political correspondent, Eleanor Garnier. So, who is this aimed at, Eleanor?
Well, here's how it works. If you can save up to £50 a month, then the government will, in what the government's calling its Help to Save scheme, then the government is going to give you a 50% bonus. That's £600 cash after 2 years. And that will mean that after 2 years of saving hard, you'll get £600 cash free. If you can carry on saving for another 2 years, the government will do the same again, another £600 top up. So that means that after a total of 4 years of saving, you could end up with £1,200 completely tax-free in this government scheme.
Okay, and who is it specifically aimed at?
Well, that's the catch, I think. This is aimed at those who are on universal credit, but also those who get their incomes topped up by working tax credits.
Hello.
And some people are saying that actually it's going to be very difficult for people on low incomes to save up this kind of money. The other thing to point out is that the amount of money, the pot that the government has got saved up for this scheme, clearly shows the government acknowledges how difficult it's going to be for some of these people to save, because they are not going to be expecting a 100% take up of this scheme. I think David Cameron's focus on helping those on lower incomes to save is part of what he wants to be remembered for, what he wants his premiership to be remembered for. Remember, he talked about that all-out assault on poverty back in his conference speech last year. And I think the other thing to point out is this is a little bit of voter-friendly news, a little bit of good news, if you like, ahead of what the Chancellor is billing as a very difficult budget on Wednesday. We know he's already penciling more savings, more cuts to come.
Thank you very much, Eleanor. Thank you. Chris Evans has apologised for using the cenotaph as a backdrop for a scene in the new series of Top Gear and promised the footage will definitely not be shown. Here he is talking on his breakfast programme on Radio 2 this morning.
What is important about this is what these images look like. And but they look entirely disrespectful, which of course was not and would never be the intention of the Top Gear team or Matt. These pictures were taken with a long lens camera from, I believe, Parliament Square. But the point is, it does not look good.
This message from Jeremy: I don't quite get the Top Gear fuss. They're doing stunts and the cenotaph is visible in the background. They're hardly urinating on it. A couple more as well. These are tweets and messages on Facebook. Grouchy says, isn't Chris Evans only pretending to apologise for creating a typical BBC anti-army PR stunt to push the new programme? Tweet from Evel. So what if they filmed at Whitehall? Big deal. The NIMBYs should just shut up. And Bill says it's a storm in a teacup. We read some messages out earlier from those who were offended, actually, and we did speak to a young woman whose brother lost his life in Iraq, and she said she was outraged. Now, the father of one of three British people killed when Germanwings flight was deliberately crashed into a mountain in the French Alps has told this programme that unless changes are made to mental health care for pilots, another Germanwings style crash could happen. Phil Bramley's son, Paul, was 28 years of age when he and 149 others were killed. Now, French investigators have called for medical confidentiality to be relaxed for pilots. Let's talk now to Phil Bramley, who also wants regular psychiatric tests for those flying planes. Mr. Bramley, thank you very much for talking to us again. I wonder if you've had yet time to absorb this report.
Yes, we got the report. We're supposed to get it on a Saturday. We didn't get it until the Sunday, and the first I'd heard of it, or we were able to comment, was the press were at the door, and I hadn't seen it at that point. Having read it yesterday, and you've got to understand, and everybody's got to understand, this is the authorities of the French authorities that are putting the facts forward. They're not making any accusations. They're just presenting people the facts. It's the judicial now review that will apportion blame, or they will get to the bottom, and the people who are responsible will be held to account. To blame the doctors almost straight off, it's not the doctors who, you know, put the aircraft into the into the mountain. That was a pilot. And I'm more concerned of the way that the pilots are treated, and that something is done more to prevent and check on pilots to make sure that they are responsible. And there's a few things I want to say. It's a bit difficult to fully explain in this situation, especially after what's happened. But one of the major points that, you know, sort of want to get across is the pressure that pilots are on. You know, they go and take these, they're put into a situation of, to get their licence can cost up to about £80,000-£90,000 to do so. And they're loaned this money, and with prohibitive contracts, if they don't perform or something happens to them, they're not only looking at losing the job, they're probably going to be in bankruptcy, having to pay it back. And I'm concerned whether that loan has been underwritten by any one of the relatives. And I'm also concerned why the family of Andrew Lubitz didn't want to come forward and assist the French authorities in getting the facts. You know, it's almost like they've... Sorry, I'm probably going on a bit too long.
No, not at all. What we know from this report now is that Lubitz was referred for psychiatric hospital treatment due to possible psychosis by several doctors, and that the weeks leading up to the crash, he'd been given sick notes by four doctors. Now the French air accident investigators are calling for regular screening of pilots' mental health. Is that enough for you?
Yeah, I think they should, we test our athletes more than we test our pilots. I think they should be tested, and I think they would probably welcome that. It would assist. It seems strange now that a year after, and it's only because it's the memorial next week, that a year after, they've come up with this. So it was going to put him, you know, was going to hospitalise him in 2 weeks, and it's almost a bit taken your eye off the ball of what's really going on. Mm-hmm. With what should be, you know, what happens with pilots.
Do you think there is a balance to be struck between an individual's private medical care, their confidentiality, and, the safety of people, passengers on planes? Or should doctors, if they have information like that, just pass it on to the airline?
I think they should almost sign a declaration that they allow all their medical at the beginning, that so they were well aware that they should give that information freely, or the doctor should give it freely to certain people who are in positions where it's of importance for public safety.
Yeah. I mean, the investigation does say that confidentiality has to be balanced with the risk.
Surely they can waiver that at the beginning of, you know, if you're a doctor or a pilot, that you could waive certain types of, you know, if you're on medication or if something happens, then it in that particular job, then it should be passed to the company. I don't quite understand. You know, the airline can get behind this and say, well, we didn't know about it. I'd like to know why his parents, his other people, the friends, relatives around him were not aware of, you know, this isn't as you know, I feel a bit suicidal, or I feel that this is 41 times. They actually were committed, that he'd been suspended by the airline back in 2009, and they were well aware of it when he was taking his pilot's, all his tests and, you know, his to fly, and they've let him back in the cockpit. How can that be right? To hide behind the doctors, I'm more concerned about the airline and their what they should do to prevent this happening.
It's almost a year since you lost your son. How are you doing, Phil?
Not the best. This is a whole new world of pain that we're going through now. With what's happened with, you know, my stroke, yeah.
Well, I'm grateful for your time again this morning. Thank you very much for speaking to us.
OK. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
So, as you know, Chris Evans has apologised for filming some scenes in front of the Cenotaph in central London in recent days for the new Top Gear series. He's apologised unreservedly. He says they will not be shown in the new series. This email from Tom says, I think it appears that people are blowing the Top Gear filming out of all proportion. The fact that George Osborne tweeted shows they were probably just as close to Downing Street as the Cenotaph. I think the footage should be shown so people can make up their own minds, because if we don't see it, Matt LeBlanc and the show will be given a bad name. This email from Miranda. We can all blame the programme for doing these stunts, but find it strange that no one puts any blame on the authorities who gave permission to cordon off the area to be able to do such stunts. Keith. Come on, guys. This is just Chris Evans trying to drum up interest by looking edgy. It's truly desperate. And this email from Edward. Top Gear doing stunts on public roads? Why? They always had their own private test track. There's no reason to be out on those public roads. Thank you very much for your company today and all of your messages. So many messages about the interview with Baba Ahmed. You can watch the full 1 hour plus version on the BBC News' YouTube page. You can watch it on our programme page as well, bbc.co.uk/Victoria+. There'll be a half hour special of the interview at 9:30 on BBC News tonight. I'm back tomorrow, where we will be looking at how the cost of childcare for 1 and 2 year olds could be about to soar. So if that is you, if you've got a 1 and 2 year old, perhaps even younger than that, do make sure you tune in tomorrow. Thanks for all your messages, which really do help to inform our programme. You can contact me any time of day or night. I might not reply in the middle of the night, but I certainly will if I can. And details are on the screen. Thank you very much for your company today. Back tomorrow at 9:15.